Oh, it is good to be in New Orleans. I just want to get one thing out of the way. Am I the only one who has beignet belly right now? Anyone else go to Café Du Monde, have a little beignet belly going on? Yeah. So my name is Nadia Bolz-Weber. I am a pastor in the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. Maybe you heard of that. And when people meet me and they're like, so what do you do? And I say, I'm a Lutheran pastor. They're never like, oh, that makes sense. They go, what do you do? And I'm like, I'm a Lutheran pastor. And they look at me like I'm lying or I'm joking, generally. And it's weird because it makes me feel like people have this idea of what Lutheran looks like. And I'm here to say sometimes people are wrong, right? So I wasn't always Lutheran. I wasn't like raised Lutheran. And unlike some of you who I suspect have been Lutheran since before you were born, I didn't grow up Lutheran. I grew up in a different tradition. It was kind of a fundamentalist tradition. And they had a couple weird things going on. It was called, well, I won't tell you what it's called, but it was like Baptist plus, right? So, there were a few things going on at that church. One is they thought they were the only Christians. They thought they were the only people going to heaven. Like, I'd have a friend, and they'd be like, hey, is your new friend Susie a Christian? I'd have to be like, no, she's a Methodist. So it was weird. They thought they were the only Christians. And the other weird thing they had going on had to do with women. Like, women couldn't be pastors, and women couldn't be ushers, and women couldn't even pray out loud in front of men. And so, needless to say, I didn't develop my personality a few months ago. I was kind of born with this, right? So let's just say they were not interested in having my flavor in their gumbo. Right? I didn't fit. And like who I was didn't make sense. So I left that church, and when I was a teenager, when I left that church and when I left my parents' house, I had a couple things going on. One, I hated Christianity. I hated it. I hated the smallness. I hated the fact that we had to reject everyone who wasn't just like us. I hated the narrow-mindedness. I didn't know, that was the only form of Christianity I knew existed, and I knew I didn't like it. And the other thing I had going on by the time I left when I was a teenager is I had a really juicy drug and alcohol problem. See, booze for me, alcohol, what it did for me was it felt like it was the only thing that like loosened those muscles in my chest that came from the pressure and fear of being human in a world that felt like it was gonna crush me. And for a long time, it kind of helped, right? But the problem is that my fear and isolation that I had plus alcohol equals bad. It didn't take long for things to get really bad. I was an alcoholic by the time I was probably 18 years old. So I also had this idea, I'm not sure where I got it, but because I didn't belong anywhere and I didn't fit, no one wanted my flavor, I had this idea that I was going to be dead by the time I was 30. And I had this enormous capacity for destruction, both of myself and of other people. For instance, when all my peers were in college, like at age 19, I was living in a two-bedroom apartment with 8 people, and some junkie was tattooing me in his living room. So different choices, right? They were making the choice to go to college. I was making the choice to basically kill myself slowly. And then this thing happened when I was 22 years old, and it was that I somehow got clean and sober. I've been clean and sober by the grace of God and the fellowship of other alcoholics for over 20 years. So, yeah. But when that happened, it didn't feel like I pulled myself up by my spiritual bootstraps, right? When that happened, it felt like a completely rude interruption from God. I was on this path towards destroying myself. And it's like God reached down and plucked me up and went, "That's adorable, but I'm gonna put you over here." And now I know what that is that's the grace of God. At that point, I didn't have that language for it. All I knew was that it was a gift that was given to me and that I didn't earn it. And I just tried to live in response to that gift. So I met my husband when I was 4 years sober and just 4 years away from 30 when I thought I was going to be dead by. And we met playing volleyball, which some of you might not know this, but volleyball courts are like the sacred breeding grounds of tall people. So we met playing volleyball, and I was in therapy at the time with this like nice middle-aged therapist. She wore lots of flowy scarves. I think she sang in a choir. She had this feeling of sort of optimism about me, which made me question her judgment and be deeply grateful for her. But at the time, I remember going to her and going, "Oh my gosh, I met this guy, and he's like really cute, but he's nice." And she was like, "Well, why don't you try it out, right?" Well, nice wasn't a compelling characteristic for me. My previous boyfriend spent 6 years in Susanville Penitentiary for armed robbery. So, like, nice wasn't something I was really looking for. And when she said, "Why don't you try it out?" that was the best $75 I had ever paid in my life that hour of therapy. So we've been married for over 15 years. He's in the back. He's still really cute. On our first date, we're at El Taco de Mexico, and we started talking about like social justice and peace and all this stuff, and we really saw eye to eye on all these issues. I was like, "This guy's great. He minored in women's studies. That's hot. Give me a break, right?" So we're on our first date, and we're talking about all these issues of social justice and homelessness and women's issues. And then all of a sudden, he said this thing, which totally freaked me out. He goes, "You know, my heart for peace and social justice is really rooted in my Christian faith." And I looked at him, I was like, "Oh my God, what are you, like a unicorn? Like some mythical combination of creatures that doesn't exist in reality?" You know, I had never heard of this. And then soon I realized that there are all these people out there who take that scripture from Matthew 25 seriously, where it says that when we clothe the naked and when we feed the hungry, we do so to Jesus' own self. And it ends up, they're not magical creatures, they're Lutherans. So the date with the Lutheran unicorn went pretty good, and then so I followed him out to California. He had to go to this PLTS to do his like Lutheran Year of Righteousness out there, and at the time I was trying to be a Unitarian because I still didn't like Christians, even though I had met a cute Lutheran. And so I was trying to be Unitarian, and oh my gosh, Unitarians, so fun to hang out with, really smart. But they have this really high opinion of humanity, like they just think that all the good is within us, and like we're kind of almost like equal to God. And I just thought, you know, it's kind of dark in here, right? In my heart, kind of dark. And it made me suspicious that maybe they didn't read the paper. Right? Because, I don't know, I just don't think we're really maybe that good. So I tried to be a Unitarian, I could not pull it off. And then my husband, who was my fiance at the time, he said, "Why don't you come to this church I'm going to? It's St. Paul Lutheran in Oakland, California." And I said, okay, you know, I'll check it out, but I still don't like Christians. So I went, and oh my gosh, it's like the kingdom of heaven in there. This church had like every kind of person you can imagine. Had black and white and old and young and folks in wheelchairs and gay and straight, everything you can imagine. And I'd never experienced the way they were doing worship before. Where I was raised, you just sat down and men talked to you. And that was it, that was the whole thing. And then you sang some hymns. And in this worship, it was weird. You'd sit down, and then you'd stand up, and then you'd kneel, and then you'd cross yourself. And I saw this sweatshirt over at the Interaction Center, and it called it liturgical aerobics or something. You know, it's like sit, kneel, stand, cross. Cross, you know, and you go up for communion, you come back. And so it was like, it was worship, but it was also kind of an aerobic workout at the same time, you know? So, but the liturgy, I didn't even know that's what it was called, but I had never heard that kind of language used to speak of God. And I thought it was so beautiful. And eventually the liturgy felt like it was this stream of the faithful that flowed for generations before us and will flow for generations after us. And we just got to kind of wade in it and come out. And it was so beautiful. And I remember after that first time of experiencing liturgy, we're driving home. And I said, so if I go back, and I'm not promising I am, but if I go back, will they like say those things and do those things again next week? He's like, yeah, yeah. Pretty much that's the liturgy. They will say those things and do those things again next week. So I started going back. And then the pastor, his name's Ross Merkel, he made this announcement that he was gonna teach an adult confirmation class because there were so many people who weren't familiar with Lutheran liturgy and theology. And he said that there would be more information about the adult confirmation class in the narthex. And I like lean over to Matthew, I was like, the narthex, isn't that like a Dr. Seuss character that speaks for the trees? And he's like, no, that's what Lutherans call a lobby, so. So Ross Merkel, now I call him the vampire who turned me because he's the guy who made me a Lutheran. And what I learned in the confirmation class blew my mind. Here's what I learned. God's grace is a gift that's freely given. We don't earn it, we just try and live in response to it. He taught me that nobody's climbing the spiritual ladder. I learned that no one's climbing the spiritual ladder, right? We aren't like continually self-improving like Tide detergent, right? Nobody's just getting better and better and better and better and better. But that God always comes to us and makes us new, and then makes us new again, and then makes us new again. And it's called death and resurrection. And that the relationship we have to God, the movement's always this way. God's always coming to us. We don't make our way to God. And then he said this, he said, we're all simultaneously sinner and saint, 100% of both, all the time. And I thought, oh my gosh, I have an enormous capacity for destruction of myself and other people, but I have an enormous capacity for kindness too. And finally someone explained that to me. So you know why I'm a Lutheran? So you know why I'm a Lutheran? Because you are the first people in my life who gave me language for what I had experienced to be true. I had already experienced all of that to be true, and you gave me language for it, and I'm so grateful. And it changed my life. So I fell in love with you guys. I fell in love with Lutheran liturgy and Lutheran theology. But I would go and visit Lutheran churches, and I'd look around, and no one looked like me. My friends are not going to those churches. And it's not because you're doing something wrong. It's because me and my friends would have to kind of culturally commute from who we are to who the church is. And so what happened over a period of years is I felt a call to be a pastor to my people. I felt a call to offer what I had been given to other people, right? So I went to seminary. Somehow I got ordained. It's a miracle. And I started House for All Sinners and Saints with 8 people in my living room 4 years ago. Now there's about 180 people. And it's great. It's great. So there's more people. We baptized 8 people at the Easter Vigil this year. We had 6 adults confirmed at Pentecost. I mean, what's happening at House for All Sinners and Saints is that people like myself are hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ, and they're doing it in a context where they don't have to check part of who they are at the door. All the flavors are welcome. And for a while, it was mostly young adults, and everyone was a little bit the same, and it is not that way anymore. We now have ex-convicts next to elected officials, next to soccer moms, next to transgender kids, next to aging hipsters. It's like you walk into church, you look around, you go, I am unclear what all these people have in common. And here's what you need to know about this thing you have, this Lutheran liturgy and this Lutheran theology, the whole tradition. It is a feast. And it is a feast to be shared. And I'm here to tell you, people are hungry. People are hungry. And you have a feast entrusted to you. And they are ready for it. So in closing, I want to say this. When I was in seminary, I had, I think, the only pious thought I've had in my entire life. And it was this: I just want God to use me. And now I feel kind of used by God, honestly. Sometimes it doesn't feel good. But isn't that the miracle? Because you know what? Some of your parents and some of your pastors were really upset that I was your speaker tonight. They felt like I was somebody who should not be allowed to talk to tens of thousands of teenagers. And you know what I have to say to that? They are absolutely right. Somebody with my past of alcoholism and drug abuse and promiscuity and lying and stealing should not be allowed to talk to you. But you know what? Someone with my present, who I am now, shouldn't be allowed to talk to you, because I am a sarcastic, heavily tattooed, I swear like a truck driver. They're having a heart attack back there going, please help her not swear. I am a flawed person. I should not be allowed to be here talking to you. But you know what? That's the God we're dealing with, people. This God for 30 seconds. This is a God who has always used imperfect people. This is a God whose loving desire to be known overflowed the heavens and became manifest in the rapidly dividing cells inside the womb of an insignificant peasant girl in first century Palestine. This is a God who slipped into skin and walked among us full of grace and truth with sand between his toes, and who ate with all the wrong people and kissed lepers and touched the unclean and spoke through thirsty women and hungry men, and who from the cross did not even lift a finger to condemn the enemy, but instead said, I would rather die than be in the sin accounting business anymore. This is a God who rose from the dead and grilled fish on the beach and then ascended to heaven, and it is especially present to us in the most offensively ordinary things: wheat, wine, water, words. And this God has never made sense, and you don't need to either, because this God will use you. This God will use all of you, and not just your strengths, but your failures and your failings and your brokenness. And God's strength is perfected in human weakness. So your brokenness is fertile ground for a forgiving God to make something new and to make something beautiful. So don't ever think that all you have to offer is your gifts, because God's going to use you too. God's going to use all of you. And the world better watch out, because you know what? That's what it looks like to be a Lutheran.